Good morning. It's Tuesday, May 3rd, 2022. And this is Rob Ryder. I'm going to talk about judicial review and trial de novo. A couple of different things that have come up over the last week or so. Then we have some examples to look at, which would be an ongoing foreclosure, a tax case, and my attempt to take the United States to small claims court. All of which had action this week, and while none of it takes anything to the end to get a resolution, it's just it moved the court. So let's talk about it. I am Staff Sergeant Robert Allen Rutluski, U.S. Army veteran, doing my best to protect and defend the Constitution. But you can call me Rob Ryder, and my email address is courtofrecord@aol.com. And I would ask, though, before we move on, that if you can help keep the lights on, that would you please, right, by sending a donation through PayPal to Rob Ryder, that's RobBryder, @AOL.com, or stick it in the mailbox, right? Just stop right now if you have the thought that maybe you'd like to send me a donation, and write down that address, Robert Allen Rutluski, 10955 14 Mile Road, Rockford, Michigan. Excuse me, 49341. Okay, so let's take a look at what's going on. Give me a second here to load some papers up. Just a second. Before I go there, though, I guess if you've not watched the videos before and now you've watched it because somebody sent it to you or whatever, right, that the things I'm talking about, you would find on Rob Ryder on YouTube, R-O-B-B-B, three Bs, R-O-B-B-B-R-Y-D-E-R, Rob Ryder. And, where would you go to start? I would say, back here to Notice of Constitutional Question and Subpoena, which is really the basis of the foreclosure case we'll be talking about. And then after that, I got involved in an IRS case for a tax case, which we talked about. And, all that things that have happened since are all buried in all these other videos that I've done since then, which, that's a lot to look at, and, I don't know what to tell you, but just the way it is, and right here, finding the lesser magistrates, that's where the IRS case first started. Then I had to do this correction because I used the wrong name of the court, and. So, it just depends on how much you like to watch videos. You start here at constitutional question, ends foreclosure in a New York minute, right? You get an idea of what's going on. Now, the thing is, right, even though this constitutional question thing got this case dismissed, as you can see, this was 6 months ago. Since then, they got new attorneys from, right downtown Manhattan, ground zero, basically, to come and try to reopen the case and re-argue the case. And all that stuff was covered in these other videos. But at the time, an attorney actually told Warren and said it was monumental what we had done to get the case even dismissed at that point. So, interesting stuff. But that was all history, right? I don't live in the past. I'm always moving ahead. So I'm way up over here where my last video was small claims against big names, which was my attempt to try to take the United States to small claims court. And again, it'll be something we'll be talking about in the video here. So give me a second and we'll continue on now. Okay, so we're going to talk about the foreclosure case first. And if you went to the New York State Unified Court Systems website, you could find for electronic filing. And if you looked up 2019-52422, Dutchess County Supreme Court, you would find the case I'm talking about. And these are all the different entries I've been put in this case since it started back in 2019. So you go down here to 58, right, which was September of 2021, year and a half, 2 years later. It's where we put in the notice of constitutional questions, right? Well, that was at 58, and then all these other things have happened since then. So this case has had lots going on. And then attorneys just keep throwing paper in, paper on top of paper on top of paper. But at some point, because they wanted to have it reopened, the judge agreed. And then she set a schedule of what she wanted to happen, that by a certain day, the plaintiff had to file their motion for summary judgment, whatever, blah, 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 blah. And then so many days later, the defendant had to object or counterclaim or whatever. And then after that, then the other party would have a chance to do something again. And after that, then the defendant could do something again. And when all these, you know, this little ringing around the rosy got done, then she would issue a her decision. So that was all up here on this motion three, motion four stuff. And then we got down here to finally where motion five, right? All the stuff from four, April 5th is when the plaintiff had to put their, you know, their summary judgment information in again, and they did. And they put all this paper. Look at all these exhibits they put in. Just flooded it with paper, you know. And it just went on and on and on. It's like, well, you know, you start looking at some of the stuff they put in, and, you know, I really didn't have any desire to try to answer any of the stuff they were saying, because I don't agree that there should be a foreclosure in the first place. So I'm trying to find something to go back to the beginning and say it was wrong. And, well, that's what we did. And, but here's an example, right? Here's supposed to be, I'm going to show this one, Exhibit 6. This is Brown's affidavit. Okay, well, let's go look at Brown's affidavit. When you get there, right, it's a redacted copy. There's no affidavit to look at. So is there really one there or not? I don't know. It says redacted copy, right, for administrative reasons. So it's like, okay, well, what you're telling me is there's no affidavit. What appears to be one or more Social Security numbers. That was the reason. So you'd have to go and look at the original record. But, you know, just stuff like that. Well, how do you respond to an affidavit that isn't there? Anyways, out of all that, because of some of the other study I've been doing since we had started this thing, and, you know, not necessarily for this case, just in general, is the idea that there's a thing called a precipice. And a precipice is like you asking the clerk of the court to do something, right? So it's a way of, you know, like motioning the court, I guess you could say. But it's really not a judicial matter as much as it's an administrative matter. And the clerk's got all sorts of powers that, not quite like the judge, but certain powers, right? So that's what we did. We filed a precipice. And we had also gone to the official records of the county to look at what is in the official records that the foreclosure is using as its basis of having a court case in the first place, which was one of them. There's a notice of pendency that was filed and a certified copy of mortgage. So let's go get some official copies, right? Go pay the dollar per page, whatever it is, get certified copies, and let's see what they had to say. So yeah, it was all things that we were doing, and we filed it in. So what did we do on the precipice? Because first we did a precipice. So let's just hang on. So we did a precipice, put in some exhibits. They kind of changed these around here. We didn't do the adjournment, I don't believe, right away. I think what happened is this letter, oh, that's on the 28th, so we got to look to see. Right, just as soon as you put the precipice on the 26th, they put a letter in from the opposing party, right, objecting to the defendant's precipice. Well, then after that, I mean, just soon after that, then I said, okay, well, let's put in this petition for judicial review, which a couple days later got this thing to be filed called a court notice, which is something I'd never seen before. You know, it's actually got a seal on it and stuff, or at least the image of the court seal. And you know, so that's really the stuff we're going to be looking at right now, is what happened there. So the precipice is when you want to have the clerk do something. And then judicial review, just to talk about that real quick, is a process under which executive, legislative, and administrative actions are subject to review by the judiciary. A court with authority for judicial review may invalidate laws, acts, and government actions that are incomplete and compatible with the higher authority. An executive decision may be invalidated for being unlawful, or a statute may be invalidated for violating terms of the Constitution. Judicial review is one of the checks and balances in the separations of powers. The power of the judiciary to supervise the legislative and executive branches when the latter exceed their authority. The doctrine varies between jurisdictions, so the procedure and scope of judicial review may be different between and within countries. Well, so there you go, right? It's a way to have the courts make a decision on something the executive or legislative branch did. Such as they put in a notice of pendency, right? That would be an executive thing. And if it wasn't done right, you could say, well, like, hey, court, can you look at this? Do a judicial review of this document and let's see if they did it right. Or if you're in a tax case and they say, here, we're going to levy you. Here's a bunch of paper. How come we're going to? Well, why can't you take that paper and say, hey, court, would you look at this paper and make sure that, you know, they're doing it the way they're supposed to? Which is kind of what we did in this last thing. And in my case, in the small claims, where I'm trying to take the United States to small claims court, and small claims or the attorneys for the United States, not actually the United States of America, because they want to keep changing the name of the defendant from United States of America, and they don't have an oath of office to be an officer of the United States, so they're, you know, they're not representing the United States. They didn't take oath of office. Well, I wanted to have that judicial review done on that, you know, in small claims court. So just, you know, different things to see what we could find out by asking to have a judicial review, which, you know, I'm under the assumption it was done by petition. But there may be a different name to use besides petition, like application, or something other than a motion. You know, so that's yet to be found out. What's the proper term to call it when you want to ask for this judicial review to be done? Okay, more on that in a second. Let's go look at what it did for us. Okay, so this was the precipice we put in, which basically said that the clerk of the said court shall, in accordance with New York Civil Practice Law and Rules, Chapter 8, Article 65, Subsection 6514, direct the Dutchess County clerk to cancel the documents filed in the official record of the Dutchess County under the heading Clerk's Minutes, simulating a notice of pendency, Exhibit 1. In other words, they filed a piece of paper in the official records that, you know, its title is notice of pendency, but when you look at the document, it's like, well, there's nothing on here. It wasn't even signed. So Exhibit 1 was not signed by an attorney, provides no notice information, and does not include the plaintiff's complaint as required by this other rule in the civil rules of procedure for New York. This is all based on New York now. All right, so then take judicial notice that in offense of the Constitution of the United States, defendant had been damaged in their persons, papers, houses, and effects by plaintiff's malicious prosecution. All defendants are aggrieved by plaintiff's act of bad faith, and it's filing Exhibit 1 in the clerk's minutes of this court, an official record of the Dutchess County, New York, United States, and are entitled by common law to damages compensation for the plaintiff's malicious prosecution, and by the maxims of equity, to complete equitable relief provided by this court. Blah, 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 blah. Right, so, you know, there you go. They took a piece of paper and they filed it into what's supposed to be the official records of the court, or of the county, and then they're using that as their basis to open up a court case. But it wasn't done right. So, you know, we should be able to do something about that. Hang on again. So when Warren went to the official records of Dutchess County, right, which is separate from the court. Now, this is, you know, the county records are not the court records. The same person may be the clerk of both, but they're not the same records, right? So wherever the official records are for your county is where this came out of. And like in Michigan, I think it'd be the Register of Deeds. It may not even be called the clerk's office. Right, but it was a, they had this four-page filing under notice of pendency, and the first page says notice of pendency of action. Okay, and it goes blah 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 blah, 2 pages long, and right, we got a certified copy. There's a certified copy, and there's the stamp. So this is the official record, right? So now this is a public record that could be entered into court as evidence because it's been certified that it's a public record. Right, this satisfies rules of evidence. Rule 901, 902, self-authenticating evidence, a certified copy of a public record. Right, then I had a third page, Schedule A, which was the description of the property. Yeah, okay. And then had a fourth page, which said it was a notice of pendency. Right, but there's no index number on here, and it wasn't signed by anybody, and there's nothing filled in down here, and right? And this says notice of pendency. And this first document said notice of pendency of action. Well, come to find out by looking at the law, there's, you know, there is no notice of pendency of action ever described in the law. All they ever talk about is a notice of pendency. So they're trying to sell this as being the notice of pendency and saying it was signed by the attorney. When in fact, the document that they had to do is called a notice of pendency, and it wasn't signed by an attorney, and it's got no, right, please take notice, there's nothing filled in. It's a fictitious, simulated legal process. I don't know how you get around it. Okay, hang on again. And the other thing we filed then is, in the same, so in the same official records, was is where the mortgage for this particular property was located. Right, there's the seal, got a certified copy of the mortgage. Right, now we can enter it as evidence. And so when you look at their mortgage, and it would be the same on a deed of trust, it, you know, they're almost always the same. You got this line here that says space above this line for recording data. Well, there's nothing up here. Normally up here is where they put the stuff from the county saying it had been recorded. Now, there is this page here, which is like the recording page, so maybe they do it a little bit different in New York. I don't know, but right, this document number isn't on this document anywhere, so, you know, what's it go to? But the other thing is, right, that all this information right here had been added to this mortgage after it had been signed by the borrower, and never signed by the lender, because the lender never signs anything. That's why there is no, you know, there's there was never a loan, because the lender didn't sign a contract with you. But they added all this stuff. And so now there's an FHA case number, and there's another case number down here. I guess that's the same number. So, right, what's in this court case? You know, where's that at? We haven't even gotten that far yet. I'm just saying that, you know, this information here is not on the copy of the mortgage that you have when you signed the mortgage with the mortgage company. This has been added afterwards, and now it's been made part of an official record. So if you don't know what this shit is, this is saying that, you know, there's some case going on someplace that you're involved in that you know nothing about. Shit, hang on a second. Okay, and so then we put that in, and because we were up against the wall that we were supposed to have put something in to answer whatever the hell they had done with all these other things here, right? So let's ask for some more time. Let's just do this. We need some more time. So that's what this letter requesting adjournment was about. And that all generated a letter, right? I mean, almost immediately. This is right on top of each other. We put in the price be on the 26th. Put the letter on 27th, and 28th, I mean, Johnny on the spot, the attorney firm, is putting in paper. And they're saying, no, you can't do that. The firm represents plaintiff, and, you know, they're given all the reasons not to do whatever it said to do, right? And I don't want to sit here and read all this stuff because it just takes too long. But they're not agreeing with what we're saying. They're saying everything's signed, everything's fine. Don't pay attention to what these guys did. And here's a bunch of different cases that were, you know, they want to confuse you with all this shit about stuff that means not a fucking thing, because I really don't care what they did in the court case before. I want to know how come we're not following the law. That's all I'm interested in. All right, so that guy. So, anyways, that ends up. Where are we at now? So we did that, and now. Well, we'll put in another letter, right? Let's put in a for because they were saying that everything was done properly in the letter from the attorney firm. So we put in a petition for judicial review. Warren Shelley Jones petitioned the court for judicial review of the notice of pendency. What do we want them to look at? The notice of pendency filed as New York State, this electronic filing document number 2, right? End index 2952422, which is how they do their case numbers in New York to determine if it's lawful and not a violation of the Constitution of the United States or New York. Right, document 2 is a 4-page filing containing a single-page document entitled Notice of Pendency, a 2-page document entitled Notice of Pendency of Action, and a single-page document entitled Schedule A. Right, check, check, check. We all know what we're talking about. Well, it says New York Civil Law or Civil Practice Law and Rules, Chapter 8, Article 65, Notice of Pendency makes no mention of a Notice of Pendency of Action, but does specify in subsection 6511, filing, content, and indexing of notice of pendency, that a notice of pendency shall be filed in the office of the clerk of any county where the property affected is situated. As a result, the notice of pendency required by the laws of New York has not been signed and certified in accordance with the rules of the Chief Administrative Judge, Section 130-1A, signing of papers. The 2-page notice of pendency action is without merit. Petitioners believe that document number 2 to be a frivolous filing violating the laws of New York and an unconstitutional violation of due process protection. Petitioner requests compensation for damages. This act of bad faith caused an equitable relief. I forgot to point out, this is the important thing on this notice of pendency. It's got this little statement on here. Pursuant to this, right, New York rule, the undersigned, an attorney admitted to practice in the courts of New York, certifies that upon information and belief and reasonable inquiry, the contentions contained in the annex document are not frivolous. But he didn't sign it. So I'm saying, well, it's a frivolous finding. He won't sign it, it isn't. Right? If he wants to sign it, it isn't. Well, I guess we can carry on. But until he signs it, then it's a frivolous filing. That was the idea. Okay, so we said, they said, and, you know, all of a sudden now, I mean, right on the heels, just past the weekend, because the second was Monday, this thing called a court notice gets filed, which I had never heard of before. Right? But it's the first time I've seen a piece of paper filed by the, you know, filed in the case that had the seal of the court on it. And it's called a court notice. So let's see what the court had to say. So by decision and order, this back in February, this court set a motion schedule. The plaintiff was ordered to file a motion summary judgment before April 6th. The defendant was required to file opposition cross motion by April 27th. The plaintiff has complied. However, even though the defendants were aware of the above schedule since February, they requested an adjournment for filing of opposition cross motion at 4:36 p.m. on April 27th, right at the end of the freaking day, the last possible moment. Nevertheless, as the defendants are pro se, the court will grant defendants until May 18th to file opposition cross motion to the plaintiff's summary judgment motion. Plaintiff's reply should be filed on or before June 1st. Now, the court notes that the defendants have also filed documents entitled Precipi and Petition for Judicial Review. These documents are not in the form of a motion. Let's start paying attention to what they're saying. These documents are not in the form of a motion. They do not include a notice of motion, and it does not appear the defendants paid any filing fees for the motions. Now, I haven't talked to Warren yet, but I'm quite sure he's been paying to put his documents in. But the judge is saying, hey, I ain't got no record of it. So other than that these documents are not in the form of a motion, they do not include a notice of motion, and does not appear that the defendant paid any filing fees for the motion. The court will not consider any documents that does not comply with New York civil practice law and rules. Any application of the defendant should be filed in accordance with the above schedule and New York law. The defendants are reminded of the importance of legal counsel. In the event they choose to continue to proceed pro se, they are advised that the New York State courts maintain court help centers, which may be of some assistance. This judge is, you know, putting out all sorts of truths, right? That because what she's done now is that the court is on notice, right? She's telling the clerk, you can't accept any more papers unless they've been filed properly. So if you can get something in to the clerk and they file it, well, then it must have been done properly. And if they won't file it, you say, well, what's wrong with it? Right? Because they're the ones saying there's something wrong. They won't file it. They'd have to tell you what it is. So, right, these documents, so back to the precipi and the petition, right, they weren't, are not in the form of a motion. So whatever that means, right, whatever the form of the motion needs to be, I'm not quite sure, but it says they do not include a notice of motion, and it does not appear the defendant paid the filing fees. So there's, you know, just three things, one, two, three. Proper form of a motion, whatever that is. A notice of motion to go with the motion, okay, and a receipt to show you paid your filing fees. Well, that's on the clerk. Clerk, I paid all this money. How come the judge doesn't know that I've, you know, been paying my filing fees? So we'll be getting that answer from the clerk's office. But, right, the court will not consider any document that does not comply with New York civil practice law and rules. So when we get the clerk to take it next time, it will have been done properly. They won't be able to just take your paper and go stick it in the window like, you know, they don't care how you did it. No. They're responsible now to make sure it's been done by the rules. It's their job. Any application of the defendant, right? Now, this is the thing. They call it an application. She didn't call it a motion. We're not using the word petition or precipi or anything else. She said it's an application. Any application of the defendant should be filed in accordance with the above schedule and New York law. So what Warren needs to do is find out what application means to the court. Okay, so the defendants are reminded of the importance of legal counsel. See, I'm saying that you could walk around with this letter. Now, this is like a, you know, these are the orders of the court. And say, look, it says I'm supposed to have legal counsel. I don't want an attorney. I want legal counsel. Can I get legal counsel? Or I want to comply with the judge's order for legal counsel. Or can you put in an application, say, judge, can you appoint me legal counsel? I don't want an attorney. I don't want nobody to represent me. I want legal counsel. Just like you said, I need legal counsel. Please provide me some. Right? You don't have to do what they say, but it'd be good to see what they had to say. What would legal counsel, I mean, somebody in the right hat who's, you know, understands the system, gave you legal counsel based on what you're saying has happened, you know, what could they do? They could end the court case for you. But in the event you choose to continue on pro se, then go to the help center. So take this letter to the help center, show them what the judge said was wrong, and tell them you want to change your precipi and petition for judicial review into either motions or applications as required by New York law so they can be filed by the frickin' clerk so that the judge can see them the way they're supposed to be. But, you know, I mean, right here, it does not appear the defendants paid any filing fees for their motions. Well, somebody's tit in the ringer because Warren's been paying $45 every time she goes down there to file a fucking motion. So that's what's going on there. I mean, this has just all happened. So we'll see what's going to happen next. I haven't even talked to Warren since I saw this. But, you know, just going on to need to get this part out of the way. And, you know, then we'll get into the nitty gritty on what Warren will try next. But again, this is a foreclosure that it's all based on going back to the wherever the official records are of the county, and go find out what was filed and get official copies. Spend the money, go get official copies. They're going to have the court stamp on it and a certification. Excuse me. Right? Like this notice of pendency. State of New York, County of Dutchess, I, Bradford T. Kendall, do hereby certify that I have compared this copy with the original. They are filed and recorded in my office, and the same is a correct transcript thereof. Notice of pendency, and witness whereof I have hereunto set my hand and affixed the seal, my official seal. And sure enough, there's the official seal. This is a certified copy of a public record that under the rules of evidence, Rule 901, 902, is self-authenticating. You don't have to have anybody's fucking permission to say that this is what it says it is and for you to file it. So you just put it in. So we did. We're basing it on this. And on this document, on the page that shows notice of pendency, which this is the only page that shows it, there's nothing on here. It's blank. Well, this is the page I had to do. All the rest of it is just, a little snow and glitter to give you something to look at. Okay. Let's go to the next one. Hang on a second. Okay, switching gears here. Now we're going to talk about a tax court case, which, if you remember, if you've been following along, originally when this came up, when Tammy got a hold of me, I had decided, well, I didn't want to, she had notice of levy, and she had to file a case in the United States tax court within a certain time, or she would lose her right to do so, right? So that was one of the things, but we weren't quite to that time at the point. And so I said, well, let's file a case against the United States and the local court and say it's a malicious prosecution because they're using all this paper. It's got all sorts of errors and shit in it, but they're using that as their basis to have a court case. And we tried to do that, and the case got, moved from the, the state court, quote unquote, to the federal court. And it, from going to the state court where the defendant was the United States, it went to the federal court, where now the defendant was the United States of America. All the shit I talked about before in other videos, so I won't get into that too much. But that was all going on, and so that we didn't lose this opportunity, we had to file a petition, which we did way back in December, right? So where are we at now? May. Still working on this thing. Right, so we put a petition in, and put all these different documents in, and da-da-da-da. So you can find this online. You can go look yourself, but so what happened here recently, we put in a notice of appeal and a notice of certification of interlocutory order, so forth and so on. All sorts of shit that I was reading at the time. But then we finally put in a petition, right? Let's do a supplementary petition, judicial notice, right? Which we'll look at in a second. Because the thing about these cases is, like this court here, you can do electronic filing on your own. But under the electronic filing, there's only certain events, right? They have a list of what all these things are. You have to pick something that fits in the event, or you can't load it as a filing into the court case. But we found one, which was first supplemental petition. It's okay, well, let's petition for judicial notice. We'll look at it in a second. But what it got to happen was that was on the 26th. Well, on the first Monday after the 26th, now we're going to trial. Right? This had been nothing going on for since December, and all of a sudden we're going to trial. Right after we put in for notice of judicial or petition for judicial review, we get this thing about a standing pretrial order for small tax cases. And in here it talks about communication between the parties, right? That the parties must begin discussing settlement or other preparation of stipulation of facts. Da, 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 da. So it'd be really good for me to know, well, court, what did you think about the judicial review? Which we're still waiting to get an answer. But, it's just really cool that they did this just after that went in. Now we're going to trial, right? Apparently we've crossed some threshold. Just like we had crossed some threshold in New York, where now when the judge answers, it's as a clerk's note, or I mean as a court notice, and it's got the court seal on it. Right? We've crossed some threshold into, you know, a different style of doing the court cases now. So let's look at what we put in. Hang on a second. All right, United States Tax Court, petition for judicial review. Petitioner requests judicial review of the lawfulness of the forms included with the IRS letter 525, dated 7/28/2021, signed by Christine Davis, operations manager, that are being used by the IRS to justify a levy on petitioner's property. In other words, this last set of packet of paperwork, they said, you know, here's some papers, and we're going to levy your property, and if you want to dispute it, you need to file something with the tax court, and yada, yada, yada. But what is the stuff that they filed? Well, right, one was this form 4549, report on income tax examination changes, and, well, form 4549 is not included in the forms in publication section of the IRS website. So if you have a court case or if you have something going on with the IRS, if you go to the IRS website, there's a section called Forms and Publications, and you can put in the form number or whatever it is they sent you to see if they're using it. There isn't one. They send you this form 4549, but it's not listed on the IRS website. It says it's an IRS form. I'm just saying it's not listed on the website, so you know it's not a form or publication of this IRS. And then forms sent omits a required name of examiner and examiner signature. So not only is it a form they don't use anymore, it omits information like who's the examiner and their signature that is the one who sent it to you, saying we've examined your stuff and we want to charge you more. Well, there's also this form 6251, alternate minimum tax computation. It's like an extract. The form 6251 is a current form on the IRS, but what was sent simulates the form and is only an extract of information that would have been incorporated in this form and not the form itself, right? So they didn't send the form. They just sent, like, you know, this is all the information properly done that would fill in all the blanks of the form 6251, but it wasn't put on a 6251 form. They're just pretending it was, because there's actually a form for all this information to go on. That isn't what they used. And then Form 886A, Explanation of Items. Form 886A is not included in the Forms and Publications section of the IRS website. I have incorporated the letter 525 and forms as Exhibit A and screen prints of IRS website form, proving Form 4549 and Form 886-A are not current IRS forms as Exhibit B in this petition. Petitioner believes these forms to be unlawful and prays for relief from the extortion of the petitioner's wealth by conspirators using fictitious IRS forms and extracted information acting as a legitimate IRS form to justify the seizure of petitioner's property and the return of property already seized. Right, so that's what she filed in, and then, there, of course, there were a couple of documents that went with it. Let's look and see what they were. All right, here's the Exhibit A. So really, this is the thing that kind of started this particular court case, was when they send you this letter saying they've looked your stuff over and we're going to, you know, we're going to do a levy. All right, so there's the letter. You know, okay, Christine Davis signed the letter. Here's the form, right? So this form is no longer on the IRS website. There is no form 4549. And the one they sent, right, doesn't have anybody's name and it wasn't signed. And here's the form 6251, where this is like all the information that would go into each of these blocks. But this isn't the form. There's actually a form from the IRS that, you know, has got all the places where you'd fill in the blanks. And, Yeah. That all looks wrong. Yeah, I don't like it. And then 886A, explanation of the items. Okay, well, if you go to the IRS website under the forms of publication, you can put in, right, put in the number, find 4549. And it says no results were found. That's good enough for me. It doesn't exist. Okay, well, how about let's find 886A? No results were found. Now, if you put in just 886, there are hits that will come up. I think it's the same with this other one, too, that there are derivatives of these ones that were sent, but the ones that were sent are not the ones that are listed in the IRS website. So, hey, you're simulating the legal process, right? So we put that in, and right away, now there's going to be this, this trial has been set up, which says we're supposed to, we need to go talk to the other party. Okay, well, and I want to know what the court thought about what we said. We want a judicial review. And so this is what Tammy's trying to get right now. But, all this is work in progress. And there you are. Filing a petition for judicial review got the court to finally move from nothing that happened forever since we put it in to now they've, there's a court date, and between now and then we're supposed to get with the commissioner and try to work out our frickin' differences. Very cool. Okay, and then finally we're going to talk about my attempt to take the United States to the small claims court. So hang on a second. Alrighty now then, so on the Grand Rapids 61st District Court website, not Kent County 64th District Court or State of Michigan 64th or 61st District Court, no, the Grand Rapids 61st District Court. Under 2022 SC-122, right, that's my court case number, and it's Robert Allen Rutluski versus United States. And they have this section here called ROA, which stands for Register of Actions, which, as I understand, is supposed to be the official, right? It's, it's above the docket. That's supposed to be the official happenings in the court case. It may be what's called clerk's minutes somewhere else. But and so sure enough, here's new cases filed and what was being asked, $200 and, right, because I'm really not even after the money. I want the judgment that I'm correct about what I said, right? And then I go after money. Right now, I'm just trying to get a judgment. And so there you go, right? Affidavit of claim is issued. Plaintiff emailed, presenting evidence via Zoom. I asked a question. So, I asked this lady a question. Hey, she put it in there that I emailed her asking about putting in evidence. Well, then I said, well, I want to file a precipice. And she put it in. All right, so let's look at the precipice I put in. Which said, the clerk of the court will correct the notice of hearing information provided by the clerk on the court, clerk of the court to claimant on the affidavit and claim returned to the claimant. The information does not provide a court address where claimant is to appear, does not specify if the hearing is by Zoom or in person, and does not identify the process server by name as required by notice of hearing section of the affidavit and claim form. Correct party details pertaining to the claimant, and correct party details, address, so forth and so on. Right, clerk must correct all these errors and so forth and so on. And so hey, this was the original. So what that was about? Well, this was the original return copy I got of the affidavit and claim that I put in. And see, there's no address up here. There's nothing up here. Now, in the past, I would have filled this out, said, well, the address of the court is this. I had looked it up online and so forth. But, when I was looking at this form here, because they use the same style for all sorts of forms in Michigan, but this is for small claims. It's numbered. It says 1, 2, 3. So it's like, well, I'm going to start at number 1. I'll just leave it blank. And we'll see what they put in. Well, they didn't put anything in. Right? But they did say that the plaintiff defendant must be in court on Monday. Second was yesterday at 1:30 p.m. Zoom or courtroom 7B. Well, how can I be in courtroom 7B if I don't know where the frickin' address is? So I wanted the clerk to tell me, hey, where do I need to be for court? I don't want to guess. And the reason for this is, this has happened to other people I've tried to help in the past, where we've gotten a motion to be heard, or in the process of getting a motion heard, and Terry's case comes up to mind. She's in Wisconsin. And she was told to be on the fourth floor in some courtroom at 9:30 in the morning, some particular day. Well, she shows up and goes there, and all the lights on the fourth floor are turned off. There's nothing, you know, it's like a ghost town up there. Well, she's walking towards the courtroom, and somebody comes out around the corner. May I help you? Right? Some actor sitting up there waiting for her to show up says, well, I'm supposed to have court over here in this courtroom today. It was an attorney that was there. And he said, I'm an attorney. Can I help you? He said, yeah, I'm supposed to have court over here. Oh, well, that's downstairs. They moved the court cases today down to the second floor. Right? This other courtroom number gave it to her. You need to go there. Well, as he's saying that, somebody else shows up. Right? Wearing like a rent-a-cop uniform. Oh, yeah, that's right. They had to move everything downstairs today. So, you know, okay. She goes downstairs. She never went in the courtroom. She went downstairs. They acted like they started the court case. And they had... And the judge is saying, the clerk is asking the judge about if they can start now or something. And the judge said, we need to wait just a minute. Okay, we can now. It was like they had to wait until Terry was not in the courtroom she was supposed to be in, so her hearing could be dismissed and they could go on with whatever their scheme was they were about to do to her to take her property. Right? So this is what the esquires do. They scheme all different ways they can. Lie, cheat, and steal. They really don't care. That's what they do. Right? They have a depraved mind. They can't help themselves. They sold their soul to the devil, and the devil just runs them around like he wants to. So anyways, I put this in against the United States, right? Under forcible entry and detainer, which has a $200 damage claim that you can put in. So I'm claiming the damages for forcible entry and detainer. And if I was to get paid the $200 damages, that would be proof that the United States was guilty of forcible entry and detainer. Right? So it's not the $200 I'm interested in. I want the judgment that says yes, right, was forcible entry and detainer. Because the other part of this law is if it's forcible entry and detainer, that they have to give you back, beyond the $200, possession of your tenements that you've been ejected from. Right? So I've been ejected from the Constitution, United States protections, full legal name, identification, electoral college, or electoral franchise, civil status, armed force, United States veterans, pay and privileges, enjoyment of my one share of the public trust, to name just a few of the tenements damaged by United States failure to provide the Republican form of government it guaranteed to Michigan and the other states under the fourth article of the Constitution of the United States, thus facilitating the forced entry of a foreign invader, the United States of America, imposing an unconstitutional democracy on the people of the United States and the several states, run by children of the devil, impersonated as senators, representatives, members of the several state legislatures, executive and judicial officers of the United States and the several states, who falsely claim this nation is governed by a Jewish fable known as the Noahide Laws and not by the Constitution of the United States, as evidenced by Public Law 105, Stat 44, or it's actually Public Law 102.14, right, which says in there that the nation is governed by the Noahide Laws. And these people are detained in my tenements, right? And so tenements are, you know, things that are yours. Other than the land itself, right? Your tractor is a tenement. You know, your car is a tenement. Your bank account is a tenement. Social Security account is a tenement. Right? My electoral franchise is a tenement. On and on and on. So this is what we put in. And as we got closer to this date, because they didn't want to, this was filed on the 22nd, as you can see, in February. Well, they didn't file it into the court until March 22nd. They held it for a month. I actually had to send this thing three different times and then call them and say, hey, what the fuck are you people doing? Right? I've sent you three different checks, three different mailings, and you still haven't put my court case on. Well, then they did, and this is the way I got it. So, Bob, what was I complaining about again? Well, there's no address. Now we're getting close to hearing date, and I don't have an address. And I get a call on April 21st from somebody claiming to be an assistant United States attorney saying they want to talk to me about dismissing the case because you can't sue the United States in a state court. You know, now I wasn't here. They left a message, but I wrote them back, and we can look at that in a second. But, you know, it's okay. Well, I'm going to court anyway, so where is it supposed to be? So I put a precipice in, and the clerk changed it. And when she changed it, now this thing has got a file stamp on it, and it's got an address written here and something here. And if you look really closely at this, you can see that they're covering something up that, you know, goes right here. 61st. What? Right? And the same thing here. This is like a sticker that's been put on top of something that may have been there before. I don't really know because I can't see. But you can see that court address has been covered up. Like they put a white sticker on here and then wrote 180 Ottawa Avenue, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Right, so, you know, they did change it. I asked for a precipice, and they did it. The clerk did it immediately. So good on her. Okay, hang on again. Right, so, right, plaintiff filed a precipice. Check. An amended affidavit and claim form was mailed, emailed to plaintiff and defendant. Check. That was the 25th. Same day. Okay, well, then I said, well, I'm going to file a petition for judicial review based on the fact that I know that, you know, what I was told on the phone, that these people want to, you know, move the case. Well, they want to dismiss the case. But I knew what they had already done in Tammy's case. They want to move it to the other court, you know, to the federal court. And I'm saying, well, this court that we're in is really not a state court. But beyond that, the people asking to do this are really not officers of the United States because they didn't take proper oath of office. They're simulating a legal process. So this is the petition for judicial review I put in, right? The Robert Allen Rutluski petitions the court for judicial review to determine if United States statutes at large, Law 1 Stat 23, an act to regulate time and manner of administering certain oaths, is constitutional, and is it binding on the United States Attorney and Assistant United States Attorneys? A public record copy of 1 Stat 23 is incorporated in this position, in this petition, right? So let's look at the law. And so, again, I had gone down to the library, and, you know, like here in Michigan, you got to give them your card or run the card under a machine, and now you can get on the computer, and you can do what you want. If you want to print something, you tell it to go ahead and print, and it saves it in a job over at a printer at a different station. You need to go to that station then with your card, put it on, it pulls up your job, and it prints the stuff out. Well, then I took what I had printed out, and I went to the counter, and I said, hey, can you put your library stamp on here to prove that it came from the library, and it's not something that I made up myself? No problem. Biff, biff, biff. Right? And so I had all these different evidences that I was going to use in this court case that I had, you know, made copies of. I'm just saying this may be a way to make a public record that would be considered foolproof evidence that doesn't take anybody. When you're doing a law, see that the courts must take judicial review or judicial notice of the laws of the United States and certain other things. There's just certain things that have to, that it's mandatory. So it's not like the other party can decide if you can put it in or not. No, it's mandatory that the court take notice of it. And so this would be here. Take notice of this law, which says that the oath or affirmation required by the 6th Article of the Constitution of the United States shall be administered in the following form. IAB, do solemnly swear or affirm, the case may be, to support the Constitution of the United States. And you can go and read this. And, it, you know, it's for the senators and congressmen and state representatives, executive and judicial officers of the several states in the United States, everybody that's in the sixth article of the Constitution, or talks about, you know, an oath to support the Constitution, this is the only oath that'll do it. This is a loyalty oath to the United States. And so if you're supposed to take this and you avoid taking it, you've committed an act of treason. Now, it could be a mistake until you don't fix it. And now it's an act of treason. But it's an act of treason until we've determined it's a mistake and you fix it. Until then, it's an act of treason. Don't fix it. It's an act of treason. And so this talks about having a certificate made and so forth and so on. And right. And so this is what I put in, because this was the state officers doing this to me. I mean, excuse me, the people pretending to be the United States Attorney's Office doing this. Well, I did all that, and it didn't really seem to matter to, you know, the U.S. Department of Justice, U.S. Department of Justice, which would be the Civil War era U.S., not the United States Union, but the U.S. under the Civil War. And they sent by certified mail saying the enclosed for filing is the original one copy of notice of filing and so forth. And notice of filing, a notice of removal with the attached file stamp copy of notice of removal. Of the above cause to the United States District Court for the Western District of Michigan. Right? So Kent County, 64th District Court. Well, we can go back here and look and say, well, that isn't what the court said they were. They said they're the Grand Rapids 64th District Court. So apparently they're sending this to a different court. All right. And as they normally do, that you got one person's name and then somebody else signing using a fictitious name. This is supposed to be the United States Attorney, and this one's supposed to be an assistant United States Attorney. And then they're showing that they filed this into the state of Michigan in the 64th District Court of the County of Kent. Well, I thought they were going to file in the Kent County 64th District Court. So, you know, what's the name of the court, for God's sakes? Is it the Kent County 64th District Court? Is it the 64th District Court for the County of Kent? Is it the Grand Rapids 64th District Court? Seems we've got numerous names of courts here. So, notice of filing, a notice of removal. So, this is something they're filing into the state court to say that they've filed a notice of removal into the federal court. Right? That defendant, United States of America, right? No, it wasn't the United States of America. The defendant's United States. Although, they're trying to make it the United States of America. Right? Right there. But that isn't who's on the freaking court case. All right, it's Robert Allen Rutluski versus the United States. Well, I got a problem with that. All right, so, but them, buying through its attorney, Andrew Burge, United States Attorney for the Western District of Michigan, and Carolyn A. Almayason, Assistant United States Attorney, give notice that on the 27th of April, the defendant filed his notice of removal and the above caption action with the clerk of the United States District Court for the Western District of Michigan. A copy of said notice of removal is attached here to and filed with this notice. This notice and filing of the notice of removal shall affect removal in this court, shall proceed no further unless and until the case is remanded. Okay, so you acted like you took it away, but it could come back. It could be remanded back to the court that it started in. All right, I'll keep that in mind. But the action they put in, you know, it was never in this court to start with. It's not in the 64th District Court of the County of Kent. It's in the Grand Rapids 61st District Court. But that, you know, again, they put the paper in, then they act like they closed the case. Right, here's certificate of service saying they mailed me some mail. And now we got the thing that they said they put into the United States District Court, Western District of Michigan, Southern District. Now they said for the and there is no for the here. Although there's other times we will see the name of the court and the for the will be added. Right here. United States Attorney for the Western District of Michigan. Let's find a better example. It was up here. Remove of the above caption action with the clerk, United States District Court for the Western District of Michigan, Southern Division. They didn't say Western District Court, or United States District Court, Western District of Michigan, Southern Division, which is probably the proper name. They made up a name. And, you know, so, and they're basing it on these actions here that says that if it's in the state court, they can move it. Right? But I'm saying that the Grand Rapids 64th Judicial District, 64th District Court, is not a state court. Because there's only one state court, District Court of Michigan. It's called the District Court State of Michigan. Not the 61st District Court. So this is what they used to say they were going to, you know, move the case. And if we go now and we look here, I file my petition for judicial review. And then per consult with Magistrate Brunick, the 64th District Court does not have jurisdiction over this matter. Further, the United States Attorney's Office has now removed this filing to the federal court. Notice of removal and notice of filing placed in the file along with certificate of service. Plaintiff notified, original filing mailed to the United States Attorney's Office. That's what they said. Right? And then they said the hearing was canceled. This was all on Friday, late Friday afternoon. Right? Come Monday, don't have a hearing. But what I did then is I said, well, I went and looked at what I can do. And I put an appeal de novo as of right and demand for trial before district court judge by plaintiff. Forward to magistrate for review. Orders provided. Right? The clerk did that. I just filed an appeal for de novo, appeal de novo as of right. I'll show you where that came. So I have to believe in every state somewhere you're going to find some section of the state legislature's laws that, you know, have to do with small claims court or small claims division. And this is the one for Michigan. And, you know, says here that conduct of small claims hearings by district court judge or magistrate appeal. Right? So what did I do? I found these on what do I do to appeal? Searching the word appeal, and it led me to this, where it says a small claims hearing may be conducted either by a district court judge or a district court magistrate who is an attorney licensed to practice in the state and who is authorized to do so by a chief judge of the district court district as provided in section 8514. If the hearing is conducted by a district court magistrate, an appeal de novo as of right may be taken by either party to the small claims division of the district court. Appeal shall be taken within 7 days after the entry of a decision of the magistrate. Further, appeal from the judgment of the district court judge shall not be available to either party. All right, well, I'm going to appeal this guy's decision, the magistrate's decision, not to have a hearing. Right? And that's what this is. It showed that it went in with some kind of orders provided. So I'm curious to see what happens next. But that's what I filed, and that's what they're doing. Which basically, this is all it was, right? Just plaintiff appeals to know as of right to the small claims division of the district court. Just like it said I could. And that's what I put in. And, well, now there's an appeal going on. Now, one other thing I had done, and I haven't done it as a document, and so it's not been posted, so I may go back and do it again, is I wanted the clerk to take notice that I demand a copy of the proof of service for case number 2022 SC112, right, to prove when it had been served on the plaintiff, or on the defendant, excuse me. And a few other things. So just real quick, Clerk Green, this amended copy of my claim you sent me is very disturbing, almost as disturbing as you're participating in the ongoing act of treason and use of color law simulated legal process to deny my relief by persons impersonated as officers of the United States. The amended copy you sent me was file stamped on February 25th, but the register of actions for this case indicates the claim was not filed until March 22nd, which seems a sure sign of Esquire concealment and deceit. But the deceit did not stop there. Someone covered concealed the court address and court name that were originally on the copy you marked as amended, but this original name and address did not appear on the copy I was mailed. Nor did my copy have a file stamp found on the amended copy. What are you hiding? What are you concealing the crime, clerk? You allowed persons impersonating as officers of the United States and their conspirators to have my hearing canceled based on their documents that misidentify the court by numerous names, such as Kent County 61st District Court, Kent County 64th District Court, State of Michigan, State of Michigan in the 64th District Court for the County of Kent, none of which matched the court name, Grand Rapids 64th District Court, on its website, and changed the name of the defendant from the United States to the United States of America. Take judicial notice, Grand Rapids 61st District Court is not a state court, making it impossible for these lying fucktards to claim a right to remove this case to a different tribunal. The judges of the court you clerk did not execute the oath of office required by the United States law as found in both United States statutes at large, 1 Stat 23, which we've looked at, and the United States Code Section 101, which we'll look at in a second. The Grand Rapids 64th District Court displays a gold fringe flag of the United States that can only be displayed in a military courtroom. Grand Rapids 64th District Court is a military district court of the United States and is the proper venue for my small claim against the United States. Clerk, these people here, this is supposed to be the U.S. attorney and his assistant, are impersonating as officers of the United States and avoided executing the loyalty oath to the Constitution of the United States. They will someday soon stretch a rope for their treason. If you do not want to join them, then get your shit together, report their treason, undo their treachery, and return my claim to the Grand Rapids 64th District Court. Clerk Green, you will provide me with the name and address of the court you concealed under your amendment and proof of service of this case and have this case returned to the Grand Rapids 64th District Court, or you resign. Anyways, that's me talking. So there you are. I had my say, and now we'll see what happens. And again, if you watch my videos, you've seen this piece of paper numerous times, right? This is a United States code. Got the little blue eagle at the top. It says it's authenticated U.S. government information. So in 4 U.S.C. 101, it says oath by members of legislature and officers, where every member of a state legislature and every executive and judicial officer of a state shall, before he proceeds to execute the duties of his office, take an oath in the following form to wit. I state your name, you solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States. Period. Right? If they need to take some other oath to satisfy the state constitution, I don't give a shit. This is what the federal government said to do. It said to do it in this form, and if I don't see it exactly like this, I'm going to start complaining. Right? IAB, got to put your name in there. Full legal name, no initials. Well, then 102 says that such oath may be administered by any person who, by law of the state, is authorized to administer the oath of office. And the person so administering such oath shall cause a record or certificate, therefore, to be made in the same manner as by law of the state he is directed to record or certify the oath of office. So where's the certificate or record that proves that the people in the Grand Rapids 64th District Court took the oath required of state officers? Because if they didn't, then it's not a state court. If it's not a state court, well, then there goes the reason or the, the reason for moving it to a federal court. I'm saying it's already in a federal court. It's got a gold fringe flag. That's a federal flag, my friends. It's already in federal court. Okay, so all that's going on, right? I got my appeal in, put it in yesterday, waiting to hear what happens. But I wanted to show one last thing, and then we'll call it a day here. If we go under case status, right? The first one that was put in said pending, and now it says civil administrative closure. So it's not been judicially closed. It's just been administratively closed. It's like a way to take it off of the docket. In fact, that's exactly what this is. Administrative closure. If we take a look, it's a docket management tool that is used to temporarily pause a removal proceeding. Now, this is talking about, removal proceeding. Talking about immigration. But really, you could just say temporary pause of a proceeding. Or actually, it is a removal proceeding because they're trying to remove it to a different court. Right, but it's just a document management tool. It's not an official act of the court. Right, so I mean that's where this is at. The court hasn't actually, my point being, the court hasn't actually, you know, closed the case. They've just put it on hold on the side and hope that I go follow the paperwork into the federal court and go argue my case there. Because if you go argue your facts before a different tribunal, well, then you gave them jurisdiction. And I'm just going to stick with this court and say, well, no, brother, you got to first tell me. I need judicial review if the people who came to do this actually had the authority to do it. And for that to happen, there's got to be two things. They have to have an oath of office that proves they satisfied the sixth article of the Constitution. And the judge has to have an oath of office to prove he satisfy the sixth article of the Constitution. Or the judge isn't a state judge, and the people that are pretending to, you know, that want to make the defend the United States of America are not representatives of the United States. So they don't have the authority to do it. Right? So that's what happened. There was no hearing, but, we're driving ahead. And, I can see now this video is getting kind of long, so I'm going to leave it there. I had one more thing to talk about a bit. I'm going to try another small claims case into another court against the governor as an individual. In fact, I will show it to you. Hang on a second. Yeah, so, I'm going to try the same thing again into a different court. Now, this, because you have to sue the defendant in the district that they reside in. Right, and I'm going after Gretchen Esther Whitmer, who lives at 5220 Oxford Road, Lansing, Michigan, United States 48911, which that's actually the governor's residence. Right, governor's mansion's governor's residence. Plaintiff is a citizen of the United States, and the defendant's an enemy of the United States. And the claim arose on January 1st and every day thereafter, including today, because it has to do with her not taking the oath of office. And the amount claimed is $1,000. Now, I have to show you where this came from in just a second. But the reason for the claim are Gretchen Esther Whitmer is in violation of Michigan Compiled Law 750-217C, which is actually a penal code, for her impersonation of and false representation as governor of Michigan. Whitmer has not executed the oath required by United States law for USC 101. We just looked at that. And simulated executing the oath required by the Constitution of Michigan of 1963. Before an officer, notary public, unqualified to administer an oath to the governor using the pseudonym Gretchen Whitmer. Whitmer has procured appointment as the Michigan Commander-in-Chief in violation of Michigan Compiled Law 32-1083 and endorses executive orders sealed with a counterfeit seal that violates Michigan Compiled Law 242, 2.42. A great seal description. By her bad faith acts and deeds, Whitmer proves herself to be an enemy of the United States and Michigan, conspiring with others to overthrow Michigan's constitutional form of government. State judicial notice for USC 102 requires a certificate of record exists to prove state officer executed the oath in 4 U.S.C. 101. So obviously the governor's a state officer. Well, then she had to take the oath in 4 U.S.C. 101. She hasn't done it. And the oath she took that appears to have been for the state constitution, it wasn't done properly. It was done before a notary public, and it's clearly written in the law that a notary public cannot administer the oath of office to a governor. I mean, this isn't hard to fucking prove. But, as I said, I'm taking her for something that's in the Michigan Penal Code, which, you know, that's the criminal code. It's like, well, you can't take into, you know, small claims court for criminal matter. But you know what? Actually, you can. Because it's to provide for liability for damages, repeal certain acts, parts of the inconsistent, and so forth and so on. And, well, this is what it says. Civil remedies preserved. The omission to specify or affirm in this act any liability to damages, penalty, forfeiture, or other remedy imposed by law and allowed to be recovered or enforced in any civil action or proceeding for any act or omission declared punishable herein does not affect the right to recover or enforce the same. And I took that to mean, okay, well, if that means that if there's a damage, penalty, or forfeiture or other remedy that's written into one of these statutes that make up the penal code, then I should be able to go to the small claims court or any court for damages, right? If the damages are less than, you know, $6,000, well, it's a small claim damage. But as it turns out, a penalty is what a fine is. And so here's 217C, right? 752.17C, legal process impersonation, false representation, or action as a public officer or employee. A person shall not impersonate, falsely represent himself or herself as, or falsely act as a public officer or public employee and prepare, issue, serve, execute, or otherwise act to further the operation of any legal process or unauthorized process that affects or purports to affect persons or property. Except as provided in 3 and 4, a person who violates Section 1 is guilty of a misdemeanor, punishable by imprisonment for not more than 1 year, or a fine of not more than $1,000 or both. So I'm claiming the fine. That's a penalty. Right? And I'm saying that's what they were talking about in the section of the civil part. And so if I took her to court for this and won the $1,000 judgment, at the same time, it would be proof that she was guilty of a misdemeanor. Right? So it's like acting as the prosecutor for the crimes that committed by public servants using the civil court slash the small claims court where it's all in personam jurisdiction, right? You're not represented by an attorney there. It's in personam jurisdiction. So that's what I'm trying to do. Now, hers, of course, is in Lansing, and I'm trying to figure out how you get the service done there, and they didn't want to do it the way I wanted at the court and got a little spiff going on right now, but, you know, I'll get it figured out. And, you know, I just do personal service. I give it to the sheriff, say, go serve the fucking governor. She's easy enough to find. She cuts a wide path going down the hallway. So, you know, but it's for the $1,000. That's where it came from. I'm going to claim. So I'm saying that any statute that's in your penal code that has a fine to it, because, you know, there are usually $1,000 or what, you could take that, you could take them to small claims court for that particular statute and say it's what they violated. And in Michigan, it's 750.217C, which is this for all public servants. This is, you know, not just the governor. It's for the police, judges, county clerk, county board, school board, all of them. Nobody's taking a proper oath of office. They're all impersonating an officer. And, you know, if you can get the court to agree and find in your favor, well, then they're also agreeing that they committed a misdemeanor. And now you have a judgment that the, you know, governor or whomever committed a misdemeanor. Because they're not the governor. They're pretending to be. Arrest the fucking traitor. You know, that's the idea. That's the only way to get them to stop is have them arrested. Okay, hey, now it has been too long. 1 hour and 20 minutes. I hope you're still here. Found it interesting or whatever. And if you are still here, then I would really hope that you would, you know, please help me keep the lights on and send me a donation, either through PayPal to robreiter@aol.com or put it in the mail, Robert Allen Witluski, 10955 14 Mile Road, Rockford, Michigan, 49341. Okay, y'all have a great day. I'll talk to you later.